Who is William Hare?
William Hare. He's aspirational, kind of got a great grasp of capitalist principles and mob psychology, and he's basically the sort of the brains behind the operation. And there's not a lot of brains between them, really, but he can't. He can't really write his name, but he's really great with figures and numbers and business plans. So they go through throughout the course of the film. They go sort of kind of incrementally change from sort of scamsters into murderers. You know,
he's a nasty grave. Is he grave robbing murderer, or is he just put people in graves?
No. I mean, the thing is, it all in reality, what happened was he married. This is also part of the business plan. He married a woman called Margaret Laird, who in our film is called Lucky, played by Jessica Stevenson, who runs a boarding house, and early on in the film, one of the lodgers at the boarding house dies, and so there was this whole kind of, well, how are we going to get rid of the body? And then, as they're stuffing this body into a herring barrel, getting rid of it in the new town somewhere, and then they are part of a conversation whereby they discover they can make money out of cadavers, because obviously the surgeon schools are you know, needing lots of corpses for their dissections, so it's kind of like they fall into it, really. So they deliver this dead body, and then they're offered a considerable amount of money for it, and then it's just like, okay, well, okay, here's scam number one. Let's dig up graves. So they go into grave digging, but the corpses are pretty manky, and also the militia has got a war on grave robbery at the time, so they start to think, well, maybe we can just, like, you know, kind of help older people who are kind of on their way out, on their way out quicker.
Right.
And so there's a couple of sort of murders which are kind of like, you know, they're almost there anyway. And then they just start to think, well, we need to. Then the pressure comes on to actually deliver one a week. Yeah. And it's okay, here's the job. So now we have to do it for real. And they go out full-blooded kind of serial killing.
Wow. So it's almost analogous to the financial system in a way. People have to meet
absolutely
targets and,
you know, absolutely, yeah.
Getting the truth and what have you, and it all comes collapsing down eventually.
That's exactly exactly how it happens.
There's subtext here. There's real subtext.
Oh yeah. And there's a moment in the film where Hare comes out with a, and part of his murdering equipment is a hammer and sickle, which he comes charging out with to kill this very large, kind of bloated, very well off kind of rich guy. There's a little bit of social commentary in there.
Oh, fantastic. It's also pitch black stuff.
Oh yeah.
But this seems to me to be very much in the Alien tradition. I mean, Kind Hearts and Coronets, yeah. Lady Killers,
yeah,
films like that, yeah, which are about people who are doing less than nice things, less than pleasant things.
Absolutely. The thing is, I'm trying to, you know, set in 1828, you've got that lovely kind of veneer of time passing, and so we can get away with it. But and also, it's a completely ironic, obviously, take on the whole thing. It is an Ealing comedy. It is an Ealing comedy, and also the humour in it kind of so broadly sort of goes from, you know, slapstick and crazy sort of sight gags to quite sophisticated stuff. Mm. You know, none of which I'm involved in. I'm just involved in the slapstick.
This movie came quite late for you. I mean,
really late.
Week, 2 weeks before filming began?
Something like that, yeah, absolutely.
Has it been a fly-by-seat of your pants type of thing? Have you been finding your way as you go along?
Yeah. Tonally, was always the challenge for this piece, is just how quite do you play the reality and keep its authenticity, and you wanted to root for these characters who, at the end of the day, are serial killers, whether you like it or not. They killed 17 people, and so you've got to kind of, so it's, yeah, it's a challenge to kind of, I mean, it's so funny actually, because people said, you know, Simon and I look like kind of middle-aged Artful Dodger and Olivers, which is true.
How are you finding the accent?
That was the other thing, because we had to dive straight in. Luckily, we had Jill McCulloch, who's a fantastic dialect coach, and Simon and I did a lot of, just before started shooting, we had a lot of sessions working together and kind of going, oh my God, are we really going to try and get away with this? You know, because it's not easy. You know, it's a Northern Irish accent, Donegal, Tyrone, but everyone around is Scottish, so it's really not helpful. And plus, Jessica, who's playing my wife, is doing a Dublin accent, just to make it even more. So it's just like, you know, you're kind of, you know, you're trying to hit, you know, we've got sort of anchor sounds that we're trying to hook into, but then just it's not helpful when everybody else has got so many different accents.
And it's such a tough accent. I mean, there's such a litany of terrible Northern Irish accents. Oh, it's such a tough one to do.
Join
Mine's
them,
awful.
we're about to join the pantheon of pretty crap Northern Irish accents, I fear.
It sounded pretty good to me. From, you know,
it's okay. It's just there are certain sentences which, if you don't have those anchor sounds in them, there you can suddenly go whoa right over to Cork. You know.
What's the secret then? Because the secret for me, I've been doing it for a few years now, is to insert syllables where syllables have no earthly place. Phylum.
Yeah, exactly.
Rian.
Signed and pined. They're the ones that we go for. Actually, there's a saying which a friend of mine who's a dialect coach taught me for another film, actually, I did, which say, prudent cheerers can cure your voice of harmful tones and rough sounds by apt, careful breath placed clearly with ease. And that covers all the vowels. I've got to go.
Grant. Cheers. Thanks, mate.